The dramatic events at Fort Sumter in South Carolina in April 1861 finally put an end to the political posturing of the federal government and the newly formed Southern Confederacy. With the surrender of the United States fort, any small hope of a peaceful resolution of the deep-seated ideological differences that existed between the two sides had gone. The new currency was the bullet, the bayonet, and the cannon shell. It seemed that men and women from each side understood that their fate had been wrenched from the grasp of the politicians and placed into the hands of the soldiers that wore the blue of the Union forces and the gray and butternut of the Confederate Army. And so America prepared to go to war, not with a foreign foe, but with itself. At stake were not just the ways of life of the North and the South, but the very future of the United States.
Dear brother, they are volunteering right smartly here. If you want to join a company, come down here and let's go together.
I have the best suit of clothes that ever I had in my life. War? I can't sleep. I can't study. I don't know as I can write.
If a fellow wants to go with a girl now, he better enlist.
People in the South had a view of war based on the Victorian chivalric romance rather than on modern industrial reality.
The outbreak of war, in effect, led to a wave of Southern nationalism, of Southern patriotism. And young men flocked to the recruiting offices to fill the ranks of local militias and the Confederate Army.
The people of the South felt that they had been aggrieved enough by what they perceived to be the abolitionist North, and now they had seceded and formed their own sovereign nation.
And they would not for a moment have considered that they were going into a modern 19th century industrialized war in which having things like shipyards and foundries and steel mills would have made a difference. Having railways of one gauge would be an advantage. It doesn't occur to people in the South that they're going into a five-year meat grinder of a war. And as a result, the South goes to war with a romantic ideal as their paradigm of what war is all about. And it is a false paradigm.
I think there was a lot of indignation in the North, and again, anger, similar to when the states of the Deep South seceded. How dare they secede? How dare they fire on the flag of the United States? And I believe the firing on Fort Sumter gave even those people in the North who were ambivalent about secession, it gave them sort of something to rally around, gave them something to look to and say, look, not only did they secede, not only did they destroy our Union, but now they've fired on our soldiers.
It was viewed as treason against the United States. It was viewed as rebellion. It was viewed as heresy against the civic religion of America.
And this anger led to a rise of Northern patriotism, of unionism. Northern men then rushed to their recruiting stations to fill the ranks of local militias, to join the Union Army.
That meant that the North could not imagine a peaceful solution to this. Treason is punishable by death in the common imagination. And as a result, it was blood and war that would rectify the situation.
It must have been with some relief that North Carolina, Virginia, Tennessee, and Arkansas were welcomed into the Confederate fold, since these four states were to provide the Confederate Army with half its food and almost a third of its men. Virginia was also strategically important to the South, lying as it did across the Potomac, close to Washington, the federal capital. However, many citizens of Western Virginia were not crazy about the idea of secession from the federal government. In fact, that part of Virginia sent thousands of men to serve in the Union Army. In 1863, the western half of the state would itself secede from Virginia, giving birth to the new state of Western Virginia. Likewise, some men from Eastern Tennessee formed their own regiments to serve in the Union Army. Another crucial state was Maryland.
Sea communications between Washington and New York or Boston or Philadelphia are controlled by Maryland. You've got to go through Maryland or Virginia to get to the sea. And that means that Abe Lincoln could not afford to lose Maryland to the Confederacy. And what Abe Lincoln does is he packs Maryland with so many northern militiamen, so many federal soldiers, that there is no physical way that Maryland can join the Confederacy. Even if the Maryland legislature votes to secede, they cannot physically leave the Union. And Maryland bows to that reality, and Maryland stays within the Union as a, for the moment, slave-owning state within the United States.
Not all Southerners were gripped by secessionist fervor. Many people found themselves wrestling with the terrible dilemma of giving their loyalty to their country or their state. One soldier in the Union Army who agonized over this question was a certain Robert E. Lee, a man who would play a central role as the drama of the Civil War unfolded. Never a keen secessionist, Lee was actually offered command of all the Union forces, but his loyalty to his native Virginia, against which he famously said he could not raise his sword, persuaded him that his rightful place lay with the Confederate Army.
Many of the best officers of the United States Army were Southern, including Robert E. Lee, and they resigned their commissions and went South. And even the Confederate President Jefferson Davis was a very experienced soldier from the Mexican War days, and he was a former Secretary of War for the United States. Compare that with the Northern Commander-in-Chief, Abraham Lincoln, whose entire military experience consisted of, I think, 80 days as the captain of some jackleg regiment out in the frontier in Illinois during the Black Hawk Indian Wars. And as he said, he didn't see any fighting. He spent most of that time swatting mosquitoes and running away from the Indians.
At least the federal government had the framework to expand the size of the regular army and then create a very, very large volunteer force. They had the infrastructure. They had the bureaucratic system in Washington to enable them to do this. The Confederate government had to start from scratch. They had none of this.
The way they went about raising their armies were they both relied heavily on the militias, but they opened up recruiting offices and offered bounties to men who would join their armies for a certain amount of days, realizing that men aren't going to join for a year to 4 years as they would in the regular army, that they needed to get citizen soldiers who would join for 90 days, because the common belief, believe it or not, was that the war would only take 3 months. Each side believed that they would be able to whip the other one in quick, decisive battles, and that this would be a short-lived war. So therefore, the recruiters signed up men for 90 days, and the states offered bounties. In this way, you had men running to the recruiters, realizing that they could leave the farm and come back in time to either harvest the crops or save the farm from disaster. They wouldn't be away from their loved ones long. And since each thought they would be a part of the superior and victorious army, they believed they'd come home to the adulation of loved ones and the cheers of their nation.
Perhaps it was the overall aims of both sides that had the greatest effect on military thinking. The South was about to fight a defensive war because, as Jefferson Davis had said, it merely wished to be left alone to live its life. There was no need to conquer the North to win. What the South needed to do most of all was to prevent a conquest by the North. It was very different for the Federal Army. The South would have to be subdued for victory to be won. The North entered the war with vastly superior manpower and manufacturing capabilities than its foe, but would the same fervor drive its army forward? It was not, after all, fighting for its very life, but to maintain the Union. There were even those who argued that the North should not go to war at all, and that the South, which was not self-sufficient, could be defeated merely by mounting effective blockades. The Northern public were calling for a quick and decisive victory, a single glorious triumph that would put the upstart South in its place and teach it a lesson. Forward to Richmond was the cry from some sections of the Northern press, for whom revenge for Fort Sumter was the minimum requirement. It was in May 1861 that the first notable casualty of the war came. Elmer E. Ellsworth was a colonel in the Union Army, an attorney by profession, and a personal friend of Abraham Lincoln. He was shot and killed by the keeper of a hotel in Alexandria, Virginia, as he tried to remove a Confederate flag from its roof. His death gave the North, briefly, another martyr. And so the pace quickened still further, until on a roasting July day in 1861, the Union and Confederate armies finally got their opportunity to face each other on the battlefield. To the soldiers of the South, the battle was called Manassas, but in the North, it was known as Bull Run.
The first 3 months after Fort Sumter were really a strange time for both armies. I mean, these two nations were supposedly at war, yet no battles had been fought. So both armies were really in limbo. And the first thing for both sides was the protection of their capital cities. And this was especially important for the South since they'd moved their capital north from Montgomery to Richmond. And so this place, Manassas, is about 75 miles north of Richmond, and it was strategically very important. I mean, two major railroads met there at Manassas Junction, and there was a set of roads leading out into all directions. So this was the place where the Confederates deployed their first troops in order to protect their capital and also to secure this strategic location.
Both sides believe that their two armies are going to approach each other and fight a grand, decisive battle that will go largely according to the plans of the commanders. In reality, none of this happens. So everybody goes out thinking that there's going to be a grand Napoleonic battle. And just as French people did for the Battle of Sedan in 1870, not long after, spectators came out to watch. They assumed that it would be a Napoleonic-style battle held on a battlefield between armies with no involvement of non-combatants. Well, why not go out and watch? And the result was that when nothing goes according to plan, the spectators are caught up in the Union retreat, and some congressmen, including one from Rochester, New York, are captured. Bull Run, Manassas, the first battle there, goes according to plan for nobody in any possible way. Bull Run was an eye-opener and a surprise to everyone involved.
When the fighting began, there was early success for the Federal forces. At 9:30 a.m., General McDowell ordered his Army of Northeastern Virginia across the Bull Run Stream, and they smashed into the Confederate positions. One by one, the Confederate lines began to crumble, and men began to flee, much to the joy of the Union soldiers, some of whom could be heard crying that the South was beaten and the war was over. However, they had not reckoned on the brigade at the center of the Confederate positions, commanded by the Virginian, Thomas Jackson. These troops had recently arrived from General Joseph E. Johnson's Army of the Shenandoah, and they refused to give way, holding firm against the Union attacks. "Look, men, there is Jackson, standing like a stone wall," cried General B. of South Carolina, as his own troops faltered in the face of the oncoming Federal troops. A turning point in the battle had been reached, and the legend of Stonewall Jackson was born. Suddenly, the Federal tide was stemmed, and the fighting began to ebb and flow across the battlefield. Then more Confederate forces under the command of General Joe Johnson began to appear, and the arrival of these new, fresh troops had a dramatic effect on the exhausted, hungry, and thirsty Union soldiers. It was 4 p.m. Sensing that the moment had come, General Beauregard organized a huge Confederate attack on the Union lines, and the Southern troops swarmed forward. Incredibly, given the events of the morning, the Federal lines broke, and the Northern troops were soon in full retreat. The panic-stricken rout became known later in the North as the Great Skedaddle. The Southern Army, that had been a whisker from defeat, had now won total victory, and Washington, the capital of the Union, lay undefended before them.
In light of the disorderly retreat of the Northern Army at the Battle of Manassas, a lot of people are surprised that the Southern Army did not push on and capture Washington. But this is the first battle. You're dealing with amateur troops, and you're dealing with a Southern Confederacy that whose strategy is more to wage a war of attrition, in which they would force the the Federal Army to bleed itself, and sue for, and then allow the Southerners to sue for peace, than to actually wage an offensive war to capture Washington.
This was not to be seen as a war of Southern aggression. "All we want is to be left alone." Those were his words, and that's what he wanted the world to believe. But also, I think, First Bull Run Manassas was such a muddle, such a mess, that it took quite a while for even the Confederate commanders to realize that they gained the victory. I think at one point Jefferson Davis actually rode up on horseback from the rear, and he looked around and he couldn't tell whether he was looking at victory or defeat. And one of the Confederate generals there, Joe Johnston, later said that the Southern forces seemed to be more disorganized by their victory than the Federals were by their defeat.
Bull Run First Manassas had seen 4,500 men killed, seriously wounded, or taken prisoner from both sides. But as the fighting wore on, even these figures would pale when compared to the casualties at battles such as Shiloh, Antietam, Gettysburg, and Fredericksburg. The events of July 1861 gave the politicians, the military, and the public a severe jolt. The war was obviously not going to be won or lost in a day. It was going to be a long, hard road. The South was rocked by disagreements between those within the military that urged that the Southern Army attack Washington without delay, and the more cautious voices that were being heard in Richmond. In the North, General McDowell paid the price for the disaster at Manassas when the popular George B. McClellan replaced him.
In 1861, the coastal war also begins to take shape. The Union Navy, which is growing larger by the month, will begin to blockade the southern coast, and along the Gulf Coast and then up the Mississippi River. This is the Union Navy applying pressure, squeezing the life out of the Confederacy, while Union armies begin to apply pressure at different points.
Lincoln's blockade at the South got off to a shaky start. It was porous, and there were many blockade runners, merchant ships, that were getting through fairly easily. So many people, particularly in Europe, were calling it the paper blockade. You know, it worked well on paper, but it wasn't actually working well at sea. Now, towards the end of 1861, the Federal Navy was able to secure some important coastal ports like Hatteras in North Carolina and Ship Island in the Gulf, Port Royal in South Carolina, and some others. So they were able to strengthen the blockade towards the end of 1861. But the blockade was also sending mixed signals politically, and especially to the one power that both Lincoln and Davis desperately wanted to court, and that was Great Britain. And the problem was this, that in order to forestall European recognition of the Confederacy, Lincoln maintained from the beginning that this was not a war between two powers. It was merely a domestic insurrection to be put down locally. It was a purely internal affair. And so a number of prominent people in Europe, particularly Britain, were saying, well, all right, if this is just a domestic insurrection, a local affair, then what in the world is the President of the United States doing blockading his own people? That's an act of barbarity. And they argued that if Lincoln wanted them to respect the blockade as a legitimate war measure under international maritime law, then he in turn would have to admit that the Confederacy was in fact a legitimate belligerent power with all the rights that are due to them from other neutral nations at war. So in effect, the blockade was giving the Confederacy more legitimacy than Lincoln actually wanted them to have.
During the early weeks and months of 1862, the thoughts of both sides turned more sharply to the prosecution of the war at sea. The fact was that in the mid-19th century, America was far from being a naval power. When war came, the Federal and Confederate navies were as chronically unprepared as their armies, and the race for supremacy of the seas soon began. It was a huge task. One thing, though, was abundantly clear to all. The old wooden ships could not hope to withstand a bombardment from the new artillery shells.
Throughout the 19th century, guns get more accurate, guns get more powerful, and are quicker to reload, relay, and fire. And that means that ships have got to deal with other ships and with shore batteries that have got stronger and stronger guns in them.
The Confederates develop an ironclad ship, the Confederate States ship Virginia, which was built on the hull of the old USS Merrimack.
And it's got guns poking out of gun ports all along its sides and fore and aft, and it's got a ram in it, because 19th century Americans were tremendous classicists and they loved the idea of reviving the classical ram. And they're going to use this to break the Union blockade.
This thing steamed out of Hampton Road and immediately began to engage the wooden Union warships that were protecting the supply ships and other vessels that were supplying George McClellan's army. And the Virginia immediately begins to sink and set fire to some of these ships.
It was not a seaworthy vessel. It was a barge. It could barely move. It sailed like a pig, but it had a lot of guns and it was covered with iron.
Luckily for the United States Navy and for the U.S. Army operating in the peninsula, naval experts had thought about this earlier, and they came up with their own contraption. It was the brainchild of a Swedish inventor by the name of John Ericsson. It was called the USS Monitor.
The Monitor put its guns in a rotating turret, which was new. It had almost no freeboard. That is, it didn't stick out above the water much, which was new. All the accommodation and running gear and everything was below decks and below the water line, which was new. It was the first, perhaps, the first modern warship.
USS Monitor's mission was limited to one thing, protect the Union fleet in Hampton Roads, and that it did well. It fought the CSS Virginia to a standstill. The Virginia went back into port and never to be seen in active operations again.
These two concepts, the Southern idea of taking a lot of thick sheet metal and thick rails, actually, bolting it onto the outside of a ship and using it as a gun barge, and the Northern idea of completely radicalizing naval design, both come from the different bases that the North and the South had to work on. The North could start with a new engineering concept. They could build a new hull. They could build a new engine. They could build a rotating turret. The North could do all these things because the North had an industrial base. They had more than one steel mill, more than one shipyard. They had engineers who had practiced naval architecture in the North for years. What did the South have? The South had one steel mill. They had almost a shipyard. At any one time, the Confederacy can take its entire steel output and build an almost useful pig of a ship. And in the long term, that means that however good their captains are, and however heavily gunned these barges are, the Confederacy cannot beat the Union Navy at sea.
Despite the drama of the clashes on the southern coastline, the main focus of the war during the early months of 1862 was still, of course, the battle on land. For the North, still smarting from the events of the previous summer, there was at last some good tidings when news came of the capture of Fort Henry and Fort Donelson, two major Confederate positions in Tennessee. The architect of these victories was Ulysses S. Grant, a man who was destined to cast a long shadow over the remainder of the war. "Nothing except unconditional and immediate surrender can be accepted," he told the Confederate commander at Donelson. And another Civil War legend was given life. Unconditional surrender Grant was promoted to Major General, and the Northern press had a new, if unlikely, hero.
Now, the South went into deep shock and mourning when the first of their state capitals was evacuated. And the Union despair at Bull Run, Manassas was transformed overnight into giddy elation. Plus, these momentous Union victories, which gained the North such extensive southern territory and control, sent a very sobering signal to any European powers considering intervening on the side of the Confederacy.
The scene was now set for one of the bloodiest episodes of the entire war. It came on April 6th, 1862, a beautiful Sunday morning along the banks of the Tennessee River in southwestern Tennessee. The place was near Shiloh Church. In Hebrew, it means tranquility. Never can a place have been given such an inappropriate name.
"God grant that I may never see such scenes again."
Their cannonade was like a mighty hurricane sweeping all before it.
The Battle of Shiloh, which was called the Battle of Pittsburgh Landing in the North, was the bloodiest battle of the war to point. It pitted two huge armies against each other. Both of these armies were relatively green, though. Especially the Confederate Army, which was under the command of General Albert Sidney Johnston. The battle began early in the morning. The Union forces literally were caught basically just getting out of their tents as they're fixing breakfast. They should have known that the Confederates were getting ready to attack.
And Grant was just stunned. He didn't expect so soon after his victories at Fort Henry and Donelson to have to face this onslaught of 40,000 Confederate troops.
But an attack does come, and the first day of the Battle of Shiloh goes totally against the Union forces. At the battle of what's called the Battle of the Hornet's Nest, a Union brigade gets surrounded. Confederate artillery is brought up, and they blast the Union defenders almost at point-blank range. The Union brigade that fights there, though, is able to to buy time for the Union Army to regroup. Luckily, nightfall sets in, and luckily for U.S. Grant, who's back at Pittsburgh Landing on the Tennessee River, luckily for him, Union reinforcements begin to arrive during the night. They're shuttled across the river by the Union Navy, and he is able to launch a massive counterattack the next day and is able to get back all of the ground that he had lost from the previous day and force the Confederates to evacuate the field. So although Shiloh is a near-run thing, it is still a pretty clear-cut victory for the North and another laurel for U.S. Grant to put in his hat. But the cost was staggering. Tens of thousands of casualties on both sides. The field was literally crawling with wounded men. The bloodiest battle that any U.S. Army, any army that the United States or the Confederate States could field up to that time, it's the bloodiest battle they ever fought in. But more was yet to come.
The suffering of the poor wounded on both sides during the wild night of April 6th and 7th is hard to comprehend. As the surgeons worked like fury, piles of bloody amputated limbs began to form, horrific testimonies to the ferocity of the fighting. It was said that wild pigs from the surrounding woods feasted on the bodies of the dead and dying. Battle was rejoined the following morning, but now 25,000 reinforcements had arrived to bolster the Union side, and the Confederate Army's attacks were repulsed. By the afternoon of Monday, April 7th, they were in full retreat, and a long line of beaten and battered Southern soldiers stretched some 7 miles back towards the town of Corinth. Perhaps the Federal troops should have given chase, but they were simply too exhausted and disorganized. Nearly 4,000 dead men littered the battlefield at Shiloh. 2,000 more were mortally wounded. The bloodbath had been the worst of the war by far, and the endless lists of dead and wounded came as a horrible shock to both sides.
Overall, and in spite of the ambiguity of that battle, you know, all the attrition, all the bloodletting, the military position for the North was strengthened. You know, Shiloh consolidated the Northern victories at Fort Donelson and Fort Henry, and it hit Confederate morale and let the Federals know that for the most part, they were the ones who'd be in charge of the Western theater.
If the defeat at Shiloh had been a setback for the Confederacy in the West, more bad news came from the Deep South. As a result of a brilliant tactical maneuver by Federal ships under the command of Flag Officer David G. Farragut, New Orleans, the largest city in the Confederacy, had fallen without a shot being fired. What was more, and just as bad, Baton Rouge had also surrendered, as had Natchez, Mississippi. Only in the Eastern Theater did things look a little better for the South. But in the early spring of 1862, even the situation there was bleak. Luckily for the South, Lincoln and McClellan could not agree on Union strategy. And in the Shenandoah Valley, Stonewall Jackson's inspired and brilliant leadership was making him a hero to the people of the South.
We've received some mixed images of Jackson down through the years, which really indicate how complex a figure he was. I think first, and perhaps most frivolously, you've got Jackson the eccentric, you know, the goofball, the one who his own troops call Crazy Tom.
He did things which are downright weird. He was convinced that if he didn't hold one arm up in the air all the time, all the blood would pool in it, and he would therefore sit around with one arm in the air all the time.
This is the Jackson who, you know, who won't eat pepper because it makes his left leg hurt. You know, the one who's always sucking on lemons in order to cure his sour stomach. Perhaps this is the Jackson who seems to have a direct line to God, you know, like John Brown said he had, you know, so he gets divine inspiration for his military strategies. And then I think most importantly, you've got the military strategist, the military professor, which he was.
He was a stern taskmaster and a risk taker. His ability to march his troops over long distances in a short amount of time earned him a lot of accolade. In fact, his unit was called Jackson's Foot Cavalry. He was not afraid to fight, and he wasn't afraid to take a risk. And therefore, his tactics and strategies are in line with those of his commander, General Robert E. Lee.
He was an absolutely useless lecturer in military science, but a brilliant practitioner of military science. He suddenly became almost a textbook military genius.
While the Jackson legend continued to grow, McClellan's cautious progress on the Virginia Peninsula was earning him the nickname the Virginia Creeper. Lincoln had become angry and frustrated by the slow speed of the Union advance towards the Confederate capital of Richmond. Although, to be fair to McClellan, terrible weather was hindering the movement of the Union troops. Less understandable, perhaps, was the constant suspicion of the Union commander that his enemy outnumbered him. Eventually, McClellan's troops pushed on to within 5 miles of the Confederate capital. Inside the city, there was chaos as the people feared the worst. Even Jefferson Davis's government prepared to pack up and leave. It fell to Joe Johnson to march his men south of the Chickahominy River, where they fought a savage 2-day battle at Fair Oaks. In the south, the battle was known as Seven Pines, and it cost the Southern Army 6,000 casualties, one of whom was Johnson himself, who received serious wounds. The North, meanwhile, suffered the loss of 5,000 men, and McClellan pleaded with Lincoln for reinforcements that were not forthcoming. The Battle of Fair Oaks was inconclusive, and it left Davis without a commander for the defense of Richmond. It did not seem so at the time, but the Confederate president's appointment of his senior military advisor, Robert E. Lee, as replacement for the wounded Johnson, was something of a masterstroke.
Well, Robert E. Lee certainly is considered one of the greatest generals in American history. Lee was a very well-respected man in both armies. But I think one of the reasons why Lee is held in such high regard among military historians today is because of his great leadership qualities, his willingness to take calculated risks, his willingness to lead from the front if need be, and also because of his great character and morality.
Lee was soon on the counterattack, starting at Mechanicsville on June 26th, on a campaign that was to become known as the 7 Days.
To put it into perspective, it's necessary to understand the general-in-chief of the Northern Army. McClellan was a West Pointer, like many of them, and he was well-versed in tactics and a good disciplinarian. And in fact, he whipped the Army of the Potomac into a good professional fighting force. They looked beautiful, they drilled well, and they were prepared for battle. However, as time went on, McClellan, who was initially arrogant and overconfident, became frightened. He was afraid to go into battle. He was afraid of what would happen if he lost. He was so overconfident that he was afraid of losing at this point. Finally, Lincoln started to push him. He threatened to remove him if he didn't make a move, to just cross the river and attack the Confederates. Well, McClellan came up with a plan. He would enter Richmond. Instead of attacking the army, he would capture Richmond by going up the Potomac and entering Richmond through the back. He'd go down the York Rivers. And so, in doing so, he'd come into Richmond through the back door. Detecting this move, on the possibility of other movements, Robert E. Lee called his forces in around Richmond to protect Richmond. When McClellan arrives, he encounters a Confederate force which he overestimates in size. He acts too cautiously, and throughout this campaign, he doesn't throw his full weight against Richmond. Likewise, Lee and his commanders are afraid that the Union forces would be able to overwhelm them and break through. What will occur next is that he finally, after several losses, which aren't that decisive, I mean, he almost overwhelms the Confederate forces at several times, Gaines Mills and Fair Oaks, but he begins to pull back towards Harrison's Landing, where the Navy can protect him. At that point, Lee and his forces begin to take the offensive. Sensing his fear, like an animal, they attack. At this point, he starts to pull back and the campaign is over. Richmond is safe. McClellan has failed. Failed not because he didn't have the resources. He failed because of fear.
The 7 days campaign saw yet more terrible bloodshed and appalling losses on both sides. More than 30,000 men were killed, wounded, or captured. The bloody battles of the previous 3 months had brought another unwelcome dimension to the fighting, that of the need for revenge. Both the Union and Confederate armies had now suffered defeats and reverses that needed to be avenged, and as a result, the prospect of peace disappeared even further into the distance. The war was now more than a year old, and the North and the South were staring into an abyss.
In order for the Confederacy to stop what is starting to look more and more like a Union steamroller, very well provided for, very well fed, very well armed, that is rolling southwards along the line of the Orange and Alexandria Railway, Lee needs to force the Union to defend itself. And at the Second Battle of Bull Run, Second Manassas, what Lee and Jackson succeed in doing is forcing the Union onto the defensive by attacking their supply lines, by going for the key Manassas Junction supply depot.
There were 7 days of fighting in and around Bull Run, and at the end of it, and for the first time in the war, it's the Confederates who are poised as the invading army. John Pope and his troops fought a rearguard action all the way back to Washington, near about. So this meant that with an army half the size of the combined Northern forces, Robert E. Lee was able to push that war right back to Lincoln's doorstep, to within 20 miles of Washington.
In September 1862, the spotlight was once more turned on to the state of Maryland. Lee, as bold as ever, was determined to follow up on the victory at Second Manassas by taking the war to the front porch of the Union, and there was genuine hope now on the southern side, rising mainly from what appeared to be the crumbling state of the Union. Disagreements and divisions, both military and political, an upcoming election that the Republicans were far from certain of winning, all combined to convince the Confederate Army that one last push might bring the entire shaky northern edifice crashing down. So it was that on September 14th, 1862, 50,000 troops of the Army of Northern Virginia crossed the Potomac River into Maryland. They were a mere 30 miles from Washington, and this time it was the federal capital that was thrown into a panic.
Politically, an invasion of the North might just tip the balance enough to bring along European recognition of the Confederacy, which was still being withheld. And also, I think most importantly, as Lee himself proposed to Jefferson Davis, an invasion of the North would enable the Confederacy to hold out an olive branch from a position of strength without making it seem like an act of Southern aggression. The idea was to encourage the Northern anti-war faction to boot Lincoln and the Republicans out of office and to elect a peace faction which would agree to an amicable separation rather than to prolong the war.
And the only way to do this was to invade Maryland. And he sought to do this in 1862 at a place called Antietam. Now, the battlefield wasn't at his choosing, but his plans were discovered by federal troops, a federal patrol They found a package on the ground, a package carelessly left by a Confederate officer. And this package contained three cigars wrapped in the secret orders, in Lee's secret orders. And when they opened up the package, took out the cigars, and read the orders, they could return them. And federal officers knew exactly where and what Lee was doing, and they were prepared for him.
At 6 a.m. on September 17, 1862, federal forces hurled themselves upon the Confederate left flank, attacking Stonewall Jackson's troops through a cornfield that stood between them and their objective. Amid scenes of the most shocking carnage, it seemed that the Union troops were about to take their objective, but a frantic counterattack by General John Bell Hood's division drove them back into the cornfield. 15 times in 4 hours, the cornfield changed hands. 8,000 men fell trying to secure it for their side. As the fighting raged on the Confederate left flank, a bitter struggle was also developing in its center. Here was a natural sunken road, a fine defensive position for the Southern troops, and a place that was to earn the chilling epithet, Bloody Lane.
Best way to characterize this fighting, it's a stand-up, knockdown, bloody fight. Union brigades will be brought up. They will be brought directly in front of the Confederates defending the lane, and they will stand there and just slug it out with the Confederates. Confederates, of course, have an advantage in that they are being protected from this natural breastwork of the sunken lane. They've knocked down the Virginia snake rail fences that run along the length of the lane, and they're using that as breastworks too. But the Union forces are coming in on higher ground, and eventually, and because they have more forces, they will envelop the Confederate flanks, and because of that higher position, will force the Confederates to eventually retreat. As the Union forces pursue the vanquished Confederates, they will cross through this lane, which is littered with hundreds of dead and wounded Confederate soldiers. So many that most first-person accounts say that you could walk from one end of the lane to the other without stepping on the ground, just by stepping on the bodies of the dead and the wounded.
Meanwhile, on the Confederate right flank, 500 Southern troops dug in on high ground were holding back 12,500 Union troops under General Ambrose Burnside as they tried to take a stone bridge over Antietam Creek. Despite heavy losses, they eventually managed to scatter the Southern troops. But as the victorious Yankees pushed on and were about to envelop the Confederate line, reinforcements in the shape of the Confederate Light Division under A.P. Hill arrived to rip into the left flank of Burnside's men. True to form, McClellan refused to run the risk of sending reinforcements to aid Burnside, informing his desperate comrade that it would not be prudent. September 17, 1862, would go down as the single bloodiest day in American history. 8,000 men had been killed or mortally wounded. 15,000 more received severe wounds. Lee's battered army was forced back across the Potomac, thus ending the threat to Washington. McClellan now had the opportunity to press home the advantage by pursuing the exhausted Southern army across the river. But even a personal visit from Abraham Lincoln was not enough to convince the Northern commander of the need for swift and decisive action.
George McClellan is a very cautious, deliberate commander. And even when he is on the offensive, even when he's got the enemy on the run, it is not in him to pursue. McClellan views his army as being the last reserve of the last army of the Republic. That's why he doesn't press his advantage at Antietam, and that's why he doesn't pursue Robert E. Lee.
As battered and beaten as Lee's army was after the Battle of Antietam, the Army of the Potomac under McClellan was just as battered. And you have to keep in mind that this army was a relatively new organization. It was the old Army of the Potomac from the Peninsula Campaign, combined with the Army of Virginia after Second Manassas. In addition, new regiments were filtering into the Army, regiments that are being recruited in the summer of 1862. In addition, there were quite a few losses in general officers during this campaign. One general at South Mountain was killed. A corps commander, General Joseph Mansfield, was killed on September 17th. Another corps commander, General Joseph Hooker, was seriously wounded during the fight of the cornfield. General Israel Richardson, a division commander in the Second Corps, is mortally wounded. And so the losses of these general officers, plus the general losses among the men, the many losses among the men, the new staffs, the new organization, and a less than aggressive general in the likes of George McClellan, all these factors combined. Plus, don't forget, McClellan the whole time thinks that Robert E. Lee outnumbers him. Otherwise, why would he have divided his forces early in the campaign? Why would he have undertaken this invasion of Northern Territory? So all that combined will prevent George McClellan from being audacious and aggressively pursuing Lee.
For Lincoln, the lost opportunity that had been purchased at such a high price at Antietam was the final straw. Now certain that McClellan was not up to the job, after he made countless excuses for not aggressively pursuing his beaten foe, Lincoln relieved the Northern commander of his duties on November 7th. On September 22nd, just 5 days after the bloodbath at Antietam, President Lincoln issued his Emancipation Proclamation, which declared that from January 1863, all slaves in states still engaged in rebellion against the Union would be free. The proclamation stopped short of abolishing slavery altogether, as many had hoped. Others cynically questioned the practical value of legislation that promised change in areas not controlled by federal forces.
The Emancipation Proclamation, or some call it the Preliminary Emancipation Proclamation, was issued September 22nd, 1862. And what the proclamation states is that any state that is still in rebellion as of January 1st, 1863, will lose its slaves. In other words, Lincoln, as Commander-in-Chief of the armies, will emancipate the slaves in those states that are still in rebellion as of January 1st, 1863. This serves a diplomatic purpose because England cannot recognize the slaveholding Confederacy in a war for emancipation. And this makes emancipation a war aim of the North. Likewise, what it says to the Confederacy, if you give up, if the state comes back to us now, slavery will be protected. And they have an example of that. Maryland in 1862 is still a slave state, bordering on Washington, D.C. And those fugitive slaves that run from Maryland are promptly returned to their slaveholders. Now, there's a third aspect of this Emancipation Proclamation which will change the United States military and the United States forever. It allows, as of January 1st, 1863, the enlistment of African Americans into the United States Army. And they will heed that call. Over 175,000 will serve in Uncle Sam's army for the cause of freedom.
If Shiloh had given the entire country a rude awakening, Antietam came as a further shock to both the North and the South. President Jefferson Davis's popularity, which had never been particularly high, plunged to new depths, and the military and political differences between the leaders of the Confederacy began to widen. Conscription, introduced in 1862, was a deeply unpopular policy, and it is thought that nearly half of those men in the South who were drafted ignored or avoided the call. To add to the grim mood, the shortages brought about by the Union blockade began to bite and prices soared. Travel within the Confederate States became a virtual impossibility, not least because miles of railroad track had been torn up. In the North, the Emancipation Proclamation was not popular. and the high casualties from the summer and fall campaigns cast a gloom over the Northern public. In addition, Northern state governments also began drafting men into the military. McClellan's replacement as commander of the Army of the Potomac was General Ambrose Burnside, the man who had been in command of the Union left flank at Antietam Creek. As overall commander, his first encounter with Robert E. Lee was in December 1862 at Fredericksburg, Virginia. It was here that 172,000 troops faced each other in combat, the greatest number in any battle during the American Civil War.
A chicken could not have lived upon that field when we opened up on it.
We might as well have tried to take hell.
Basically, Burnside got the jump on Robert E. Lee and got his army to the banks of the Rappahannock River while Robert E. Lee was nowhere around.
He doesn't have his troops into place until December. It's a cold and windy December. He has to cross rivers and he needs pontoon bridges and they're being brought up slowly. And it's a wet December, so there's alternately mud and ice that the soldiers have to trudge through and cold that they have to deal with.
The problem was that the pontoon boats weren't coming. And it took a long time for Ambrose Burnside to get his pontoons. And that meant that he wasn't able to build his bridges on schedule. And that meant that the rebels had time to quite deliberately build some excellent firing positions with two corps up on Marie's Heights overlooking the Union crossings at Fredericksburg.
Still, Ambrose Burnside realizes that the reason why he's relieved of, that why his predecessor's relieved of command, George McClellan, is because he wasn't aggressive enough in launching an offensive campaign. So he knew he had to attack before winter set in. Problem is, now Lee knows what he wants to do, and it's much easier to defend than it is to attack.
And by the time Burnside gets his bridges built and starts crossing, the whole rebel army is sitting on top of Marie's Heights at Fredericksburg, firing down from the front and from the flank on the Union as they cross.
The Union forces cross the Rappahannock, go through Fredericksburg, and confront the Confederate forces at Mayor's Height. But the problem they have is that they're at the foot of a hill. So what do? Burnside orders the attack anyway.
The Union forces begin marching, line abreast, brigade by brigade, across the open space between the town and Marie's Heights. And the rebels are standing behind a slightly sunken road, behind a stout stone wall in a natural trench system. To the front and to the flank, they're along a ridge, a bare ridge, that can fire into the flank of the Union forces as they walk up this hill. And they just march up the hill towards that sunken road, and they're massacred. Brigade by brigade, in dribs and drabs, Burnside sends his troops up this gentle slope where there is no cover except one little ditch, and they are massacred as they try to climb the heights to Fredericksburg.
Now, some people don't think of it as much of a massacre, but that's what it was. They charge and charge and charge again into Confederate rifle fire until finally Burnside and his officers realize that they will not be able to rout the Confederate forces, and they retreat.
We tend sometimes to place all our emphasis on the Eastern theater of war. Hence, the Battle of Fredericksburg generally is seen as the final big battle of 1862. But it wasn't. In the Western theater of war, in the Tennessee theater, another battle was taking shape. And that battle is going to be called the Battle of Murfreesboro by the Confederates, or the Battle of Stones River by the Union.
Here, between December 31st, 1862, and January 2nd, 1863, the Confederate General Braxton Bragg, commanding the Army of Tennessee, faced the Union general, William S. Rosecrans, commander of the Army of the Cumberland. Appalling weather preceded a confusing and bloody battle, marked by massive Confederate frontal attacks against Union positions. In the face of heavy losses, the Confederates continued to charge, and on January 2nd were pummeled by Union artillery as they crossed Stone's River. Despite 13,000 Union casualties, Lincoln was desperate to claim the victory. And so the bloody year of 1862 came to a close. For all the pain and suffering, deprivation and hardship, broken bodies and makeshift graves, was an end to the war any nearer? It seemed not. In the North, a poor showing in the November elections and the disaster at Fredericksburg had put Lincoln under enormous pressure. Some thought the strain was beginning to tell. In the South, the victory at Fredericksburg had come as a welcome boost, and anyway, there was little else to do but carry on. Already, thousands of sons of the South had died to preserve the Southern way of life. The Confederacy had come within a hair's breadth of defeat and within touching distance of victory. The war was not even halfway through, and the sacrifices made by the men and women of the North and the South were far from over. In fact, though few would have believed it possible, matters were to get steadily worse.